This is one of the more expensive smartphone adapters that you can buy for your telescope. But it's worth every penny. And that's because it's the last one you'll ever need to buy. Big words, I know, but let me explain. Welcome back to the Reflactor channel. This is the new ACCUVIEW smartphone adapter for your telescope. It comes in a nice decorative bag. And also hidden in this bag is a wonderful Bluetooth button adapter. About 5 months ago, I reviewed the little brother to this. It was called the Move Shoot Move. But the manufacturer did something totally unexpected. They halted production of this one to apply improvements to it. The end result was, of course, the ACCUVIEW. Most of the improvements were small, but one of them was a real game changer for quite a few watching this. They enlarged the eyepiece clamp so that it could hold up to 2-inch eyepieces. Now, if you recall from that video 5 months ago, I highly recommended the Move Shoot Move adapter for everybody unless you had the 2-inch eyepieces. If you needed to use your 2-inch eyepieces, well, then you were stuck using the Celestron NeXYZ. Now, in that video, we went over all the pros and cons of using this one. But now that this one clamps on 2-inch eyepieces, this is the one to get. It has it all. It holds the 2-inch eyepieces. It also has the 3-axis adjustment, and the axes are all rigid and perpendicular, which is pretty darn cool. Let's take a closer look. Now, later on in the video, I'm going to show you how to hook up almost any smartphone to one of these to get a perpendicular optical path and take wonderful astrophotography pictures. Let's go to the workbench. So here's a good view of them. You can see that they actually look very, very similar. The main visual difference, of course, is that they have this bigger area for the 2-inch eyepieces to go into, whereas this one did not quite fit the 2-inch eyepiece. And by the way, the pricing for these right now is about $65 as of summer of 2023. So let's put the old one aside. The ACCUVIEW is all metal. That's right. It seems to be made from a machined metal, and all the joints are really tight and perpendicular. I think the only plastic on this is perhaps this knob right here. Maybe this knob too. Other than that, it seems to be all machined metal. The axis adjustment knobs here for this one and this one are a knurled metal. One side note about those, I actually had sent feedback on the old one that said that this came off, and when I checked, there was no filed flat area for the set screw to bite into. So what they did was, and one of the improvements is, they actually, somehow in their manufacturing process, they started filing down the tops of the axles so that the set screw would have something to bite into. This thing is, it's really high quality, and it weighs 2 ounces less than the Celestron NeXYZ. I'm not sure how they did that while maintaining the rigidity and perpendicularity of these joints. But as you can see, there's quite a bit of adjustment in all three axes.
Let's take a look at a time lapse of the Z axis. Now the side-to-side axis. And how about the forward-to-back axis?
As with the previous little brother version, it doesn't really matter if your camera is in the middle of your smartphone or if it's in the corner, like a lot of iPhones. I know some of you actually ran out of adjustment room with other adapters because of this very issue of the smartphone camera location, but not on this one. This thing can accommodate phones up to about 3.55 inches wide. As you can see, there's plenty of room for my phone. The great thing about how this clamps and the adjustment that you have in this direction is that it keeps any buttons that you don't want being pushed from getting smashed by the adapter. For example, my Samsung has a Bixby button that often in most adapters actually gets squished. In this one, I can actually adjust it out of there, but if you don't, I actually just take an X-Acto blade and I remove that Bixby button from the case. It doesn't affect the phone at all, but I remove it from the case. But that's not really needed with the ACCUVIEW because you have so much adjustment going this way. So in summary, it's all metal, it's rigid, it's perpendicular, all the axes are perpendicular, it's fully adjustable in 3 axes, and it fits both 1.25-inch eyepieces and 2-inch eyepieces. So let me show you how to hook up any smartphone to this adapter. Now, by the way, if you want to help support this channel, please use the Amazon affiliate link down in the description below. It doesn't cost you anything extra, but Amazon shovels a few pennies my way, so I don't have to rely so heavily on sales of my best-selling science fiction novel series, Red Hope, available on Amazon and Audible.
There is eventually a limit on eyepiece size. If you have one of these big coconut-sized eyepieces, well, good luck finding an adapter that'll fit one of these. Now let me show you the proper way to hook up any smartphone to this adapter. Mount the eyepiece to the adapter first. The biggest epiphany that I've had over the years regarding smartphone astrophotography is attaching the eyepiece to the adapter first. It makes the process so much easier. You'll want the eyepiece lens or the rubber cup interface to be in the same plane as the pad where the phone sits. Now the trick is to use a ruler. That's what I use. Just like this. I flip the whole thing upside down, and then I gently place the eyepiece through the hole. Get it roughly centered on that little grabbing V, the little valley there. And then you slowly tighten the clamp. Make sure it's tight enough to hold everything rigidly, but not so that it breaks your eyepiece. Now, congratulations, you've just created a perpendicular optical path. Next up, turn your smartphone on and get the camera up and running. And then we're going to mount it onto the eyepiece. Now, let's try to get it relatively close. We might not be able to get it right on immediately. That's okay. We have some adjustment. Let's make sure it's as perpendicular as possible and to tighten the clamps down. All right. For this next step, we want the surface to be as bright as possible, so get a piece of paper. And we're just going to start adjusting the X and Y axes until we get this eyepiece generally circled right there. See if we can get this relatively quick. That looks pretty darn close, actually. That's pretty good. If you want, you can do some fine tuning to get it left and right, but this actually looks pretty darn good. Now you may be wondering what this Z-axis adjustment is for. When might that be needed? Well, that helps out with either awkwardly long or short eyepieces or weirdly shaped eyepieces. Sometimes the eyepieces, they get fat, so you have to clamp them way down here. So that's why you might want to adjust this distance. Also, it helps sometimes if you need a little bit more distance to get perfect focus. And of course, speaking of perfect focus, the best way to achieve that when looking at a LCD screen or on your laptop or something like that is actually to put a BAHTINOV mask on the front of your telescope. I have a whole video for how those even work. I'll put that in the description box below. Okay, for step three, I'm going to show you how to set up your smartphone camera app settings. Now, to make sure that this is a little bit more viewable, I'm just going to put a dark cap over this so we can view the screen. Your smartphone may be smart, but the camera app, unfortunately, is not usually very smart. Smartphone cameras are designed to take photos of things here on the Earth. If you point them in the sky, especially at night, they have no idea what to focus on or how much light to let in. If you don't properly set up the camera app, you're just going to get blurry pictures. With that said, it's very important that you have control over things like manual focus, the shutter speed, and ISO. I'll explain ISO in a moment. The fix for a lot of these is pretty easy, especially if you have a Samsung Galaxy phone like this one. This is an S9 Plus. It's getting a little bit old now, but I love the camera app interface on this. It's so simple. I have no plans to get rid of it. Let me show you how I set this up. I've got the camera app up, and there's a little icon down here that says More. Push on More. Few choices come up. You want to find the one that says Pro. Now there is one that says Pro Video. That's for another time. We're going to focus on Pro right now. So I click on Pro. The most important one right now is this one labeled MF. Now, for some reason, that always makes me think of Samuel L. Jackson. In this case, though, the MF stands for manual focus. I'll go ahead and push that. It brings up a little slider scale, and this is where I can tell my phone what to focus on. Over on the left, I see a flower, and over on the right, I see some mountains. Now, if I wanted to focus on something very close, I'd move the slider over here to the flower. Now, if I wanted to focus on something very far away, say like the moon or the planets, I would move it all the way to the right. That effectively focuses it to something that is infinitely far away. Great, that part's done. Now for the shutter speed and the ISO. These two are somewhat intermingled, but let's talk about the ISO first. It stands for International Standards Organization. Now, ISO is an old acronym from the film days that referred to how sensitive the film was to light. You could actually buy film with different ISO settings. The lower the number was, the sharper the film image would be, but the trade-off was that you needed a lot more light. Now, jump forward to modern times, and ISO simply refers to how sensitive the camera sensor will be to light. So, the lower the number, the less sensitive, and the higher the number, the more sensitive. So you touch this icon, and there's a little slider that shows up. Mine goes all the way from 800 at the max to down to 50 at the bottom. Yours will probably be different, so feel free to experiment. For bright objects like the Moon and Jupiter and the International Space Station, I may need to turn it down to, say, 200 to 400, typically. A full moon, you're going to be looking at these lower numbers, because the full moon is just that bright. Now, that also depends on the shutter speed, which plays kind of a balancing act with your ISO settings. At its simplest, the shutter speed helps you capture fast-moving objects. Now, the smartphone cameras really don't have a physical shutter anymore, so instead, that setting controls the amount of time that the camera sensor collects light data. So in a way, it acts like a virtual shutter. So you can see now why it plays tag team with the ISO setting. The longer you have the shutter open, the more light you collect. And if you have your ISO also set to a really high number, well, it will seem to just amplify the amount of light collected. The trick is to experiment with your smartphone. For the moon, you can use very short shutter speeds. So I'll go ahead and click on this. It's done typically in a fraction. So mine, the fastest shutter speed is 1/6,000th of a second and all the way up to 10 seconds. Let's take it down to something reasonable, 1/250th of a second right there. For the moon, I generally use short shutter speeds. That's because the moon is so bright. Now, same with Jupiter and the International Space Station. I generally use shutter speeds of about 1/500th to maybe a little bit slower than that. Especially, you know, with the ISS, if you go any slower, it might be a little bit streaky. It depends on the method you're using to capture the space station. Now, with the moon, I use really fast shutter speeds, and I turn the ISO nearly all the way down because, again, the moon is insanely bright. So you might be wondering, why would anybody use a long shutter speed? For example, why would you push this up to 10 seconds? Well, you would use that if you're trying to photograph something that is a very dim object in the sky, like a nebula or a star cluster. And of course, that brings up the one big caveat with astrophotography in general. Unless your telescope is actually tracking the target through the sky, long shutter exposures will create streaked images as the sky moves in front of your telescope. And the more zoomed in you are, the more dramatic the streaking is. The solution, of course, is to use a motorized telescope mount, but that's a totally different subject for a different video.
Now, next up is the, wait a second, it looks like you haven't pushed the like or the subscribe button. If you find this video helpful, please push the like and subscribe button. It really helps small channels like this one. Thank you. Now, in theory, this is the easiest part. You just mount the whole contraption into your telescope like this, and you tighten it down. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that this whole contraption weighs a lot more than just an eyepiece. In fact, your telescope may actually start to dip down. You're going to need to put some counterweights down there. Now, if you want, I have actually a video where you can make these homemade, super cheap counterbalances. They're magnetic, and they slide up and down pretty easily. And this is just a real quick way to counterbalance any of the telescope. I have these on all of my telescopes. I'll put a link to the video down in the description box. Next up, we have to figure out how to take a picture without shaking the whole thing. Take a picture. Now, this seems obvious, right? Well, not quite. If you push the shutter button on the screen, it'll probably vibrate a little bit, and you'll end up getting a kind of a shaky or blurry or streaky image. The first line of attack is to set up your shutter with a delay. And the way you do that is you push the delay icon up here. Let's set it for 2 seconds. So with that idea, you push the shutter button, and hopefully after about 2 seconds, the shakes will all be gone, and the picture is taken. Let's turn that back to off. Next up for shutter control options is the word cheese. Oh, you see that right there? You can set up most modern phones to be activated by a word, and the most common word that I know of is cheese. So every time I say the word cheese, it takes a picture. Cheese! It's a pretty nice deal, and of course, no shaking involved. Lastly is the Bluetooth shutter button. This is what I use all the time. At the time I'm making this video, the ACCUVIEW adapter actually comes with a Bluetooth shutter button. This is actually this is the one that I usually use. I already have one, so I'm going to use mine. Every time I push this button, it takes a picture. So there are several ways to instigate the shutter button without actually touching the camera, or at least doing it so that all the vibrations are gone.
The ACCUVIEW smartphone adapter is not the cheapest one that you can buy, but it will be the last one you ever need to buy. And as an added bonus, it comes with a wireless Bluetooth shutter button included.
Now again, I have an Amazon affiliate link down in the description box below. It costs you nothing extra, but it does help out the channel a little bit. Since we're talking about smartphones, how would you like to use a free app on your smartphone to turn your smartphone into a precision telescope pointing device? Well, check out this new video about Astrohopper. That's the app that is free and it runs on any smartphone. Or you may want to check out this video down here. That's a pretty fun one too. Thanks for watching, and I hope you have a blast taking pictures of the night sky. Clear skies, everybody.